Start with some of what Mark already said and kind of help us understand. Our theme through March is going to be how God is on the move, and I hope you'll get excited about what God is doing. It's always scary, just so you know, for the pastor when God is on the move, because changes bother everybody. And so it's scary because people don't like difference, right? We like it the way we like it. And so I'm hoping we get excited. Mark shared the youth intern coming. I hope you will be excited and receive him well. He'll be here the second weekend of March, at least to be here. Hopefully by the end of March, we find him a place to stay. And he doesn't have furniture. He doesn't have much. And so we may need to help with that and get him rolling. Jordan Scott has been working. Part of what he's been doing is working with the Baptist Student Union on Missouri State campus. And I will say one thing about Jordan Scott. He will not meet a stranger. And he will push the contemporary button all the way to me having gray hairs. But I think it'll be good. And I think it will move in a good direction. And so pray as he comes. I think it'll be exciting. Mark is going to take on more of a role of discipleship and assimilation. I'm probably as equally excited about Jordan coming as well as Mark getting involved, because God has given us way more than who shows up on a Sunday morning here. And we need to plug them in. We need to get them connected. We need to get everyone involved, and I'm excited that Mark will be working in that role, and excited that God is allowing us to do these things. And then also we're taking on Virginia Mines. This is a busy month in March, and I hope you can help. He just texted me some of the things. We got to do a lot of painting out there. We want to spruce the church up. There are some cracks in the sanctuary wall that would be great to fix. Flooring in the foyer and bathroom, a counter in the foyer, change the doors going into the foyer, and power wash the outside of the building. We're going to put up a new sign and have signs on the road and things of that nature. And so it's almost like starting a new church. It's going to be called Memorial Baptist Church, and then it'll have on their Virginia Mines campus. And so we're keeping their identity with the Virginia Mines, but we're also going to tell them, hey, this is now Memorial Baptist Church. And so I hope you'll pray for CJ. I hope you'll say, hey, I can take. Now listen, I don't know if it's, I think it's next week. In the evenings, he plans to be there. We'll put out a schedule so that you could get a hold of him and connect. If you want to get to know CJ better, on Wednesday nights through March, he's going to be teaching on how to have a godly family. It's a little too late for me, but hopefully y'all will come and get plugged in and encourage him as he teaches in the month of March on Wednesday nights. Upward Celebration is also coming in March. It's the 19th, I believe, 18th, 19th, somewhere in there. And I'm excited, or maybe 20th. It's one of those, whatever that Sunday is. And anyway, I'm excited for what God is doing. I'm excited. There's one thing that goes home with the kids. I hope you'll pray. It's a video that goes home the week before we share the plan of salvation with all of those who have played upward basketball. I want us to be people praying that God will reach these young people with the gospel, and also the moms and dads. I'm also excited. Light Academy has this influx, and we got to decide how we're going to be moving forward. There's a whole lot of kids calling, not the kids actually, but I want to come there. Anyway, but the parents are calling, wanting to get their kids enrolled, and it's exciting. And I really believe because the gospel is taught in our preschool, God is moving and allowing us to see fruit from that. There's a new discipleship class that is full. I'm excited about that. Started last week, and it's good to see how God is working and moving. And so we're going to set out some dates and times of special prayer times, of special fasting days as we go through the month of March. Because the one thing I understand is when God starts to move, you either get on or he moves elsewhere. God will use his people if his people are willing to be used. But if his people choose not to be used, God goes elsewhere to get his work done. And so I pray you'll get involved, get excited about how God is working and moving here at Memorial Baptist Church and how he's using you to do things in our community. So we are looking at Ecclesiastes chapter 3. The world just keeps turning, doesn't it? I thought it was interesting, that song. I actually thought we'd open with it, but the writer of the song, and I don't even know who the birds are, by the way. It was mentioned in the commentary. And then when I heard the song, I said, okay, I remember the phrase turn, 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 but I don't remember anything else about the whole thing. And but it was fascinating to me. The writer of it, Peter, whoever, Seeger, is it Seeger? Yeah, that guy. And so, you know what's funny is every time he gets royalty checks from that song, because I think he feels bad that he stole it from God in Israel, he gives half of it to the Israel Foundation of his royalties for that song. And so Bob sung it. He should turn it in and pay for that. Okay, go to Ecclesiastes chapter 3. Says this, to everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. Now I want you to just see the word purpose as we start. Because sometimes we think seasons are useless, but there is a purpose for it. I love the warm weather in February, but the purpose, I like it when it's real cold for a long period of time, just for the simple fact there's less bugs. Right? And so since it's been warm, there's maybe a higher probability of bugs. Apparently there was a fly in my truck and was dormant, hit 75. All of a sudden this fly's like, hey, I want to have fun in your truck. Isn't it annoying? And so I'm hoping that we don't have that. But there's a purpose to every season. Ecclesiastes 2 says a time to be born and a time to die. Just so you know, you do not plan either one of those. It happens. A time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. Now, just so you know, that it's not giving us a license to kill. I just want to make that clear. Of what's happening. These are all, by the way, descriptions and not prescriptions of how to behave. And so I just want you to know there is a time of kill. Some people think maybe since he said there was a time to plant, there's also a time to pluck up. He's probably talking about cattle. He could be. Because there is a time, right? There's a time, I've never had cattle, but there's a time when you give all your money to heal that cow, right? Got to keep it alive. 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 Ooh, let's kill it. It's fat, right? And so there's a time to heal. There's a time to kill. There's a time to break down, time to build up. There's a time to weep, a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones, and a time to gather stones, trying to figure that phrase out. I'm pretty sure it's meaning on building, whether it's a wall or some other thing in life, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. And as one commentator said, that time is when you're dating my daughter. Just so you know. A time to get and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to cast away. And if you've had a garage sale, that's understandable, isn't it? Unless you and your wife can't agree what should be kept and what should be cast away. Verse 7, a time to rend and a time to sow. Ain't all that sure when there's a time to rend, other than you gained weight. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. That's probably a hard one to understand as we live life, because we usually speak when we should be quiet and are quiet when we should speak. Verse 8, a time to love and a time to hate, time of war and a time of peace. What profit has he that worketh in that wherein he laboreth? Verse 10, I've seen the travail which God has given to the sons of men to be exercised in it. He has made everything beautiful in his time. He also has said, set the world in their heart, so that no man can find out the works that God maketh from the beginning to the end. In this verse that was mentioned earlier, and we look at it, it is a pivotal point in the chapter, and we do need to understand that God has put in our hearts, in our minds, our understanding that there should be something more. See, here's our problem in life, is we think this is all there is. We kind of worship the globe. And I didn't want y'all to have flashbacks, but I started to throw it in the air when they were singing turn, turn, turn. But some of y'all would have been like, woo, I don't know where I went. Anyway, but this, we worship the globe. We worship the earth. We worship what is happening here. We think this is all there is. And this is not all there is. NASA this week made a huge announcement, and they think it's going to help us find out how we got here. Right? Well, we found some planets way out there. Well, I'm telling you, there's things out there we don't know, because God put it into existence. And if he wants other planets, there's other planets. And if there's life on other planets, guess what? God put them there. And so it's okay with me, but it's like, oh, we're going to find there's these four planets going, was it four or five planets going around this little sun, 400 and some billion miles away. We could never get there. And so, but we got this telescope way out in the middle of nowhere. And so NASA's like, oh, we think it could have water. That just always fascinates me, because they think if they can find water, they can find life. And because then, by seeing water on that planet, they'll be able to find out how we got here. Turn, turn, turn. See, it's all about this. It's all about us. But God has put it in our hearts to understand there's more than this. That's what Romans chapter 1 tells us. But we start to worship the creation rather than the creator. See, our focus can't be totally on the world. God has made this. God has placed it into existence. And God one day will destroy it and make a new heaven and a new earth. If we try to find our purpose under the sun, we're going to miss out. Isaac Watts said, time, like an ever-rolling stream, bears all his sons away. One day y'all are all going to be washed away, because the sun is just, it's just going to keep turning. One day you're here, one day you're not. As some have said, Father Time is undefeated. Right? Just look around. Some of y'all who are maybe under 20 don't understand. But one day you will wake up and you will fully understand that time catches you. The things you thought you could do are no longer within your ability. And when you tell your kids you used to, they laugh. No. Ecclesiastes 3:2 says, a time to be born and a time to die. Tonight, I hope you would come back, but we're going to try to prepare you to die. All right? If you're prepared to die, life is good. Our problem is we're not prepared to die. And death just kind of sneaks up on us. I'm telling you, we need to understand God has given us life to enjoy, and I don't want life to hasten and be done before it's time that God has planned or existed, but I'm prepared to die. And if God takes me, it's okay, because God has a plan, and it is in my plan. I enjoy, believe it or not, getting up every morning, and I exercise. Did about 7 miles of exercise yesterday, lifted some weights, gained 4 pounds. It's because I ate dinner way too much. But anyway, it's like I enjoy it. But if I think because I exercise, I'm extending my life and I'm going to prevent death from coming. No, it's good to be in shape. It's good to have health. But don't think that you are extending your life. It's in the hands of God. It's in the hands of God. See, the whole purpose Solomon is trying to get across is to expose the foolishness of a life lived without God in order to push us to enjoy God and His gifts. Everything under the sun is for us to enjoy. If we understand God has a purpose and a plan, I think the most awesome thing in the world to hold on to is that God is in control. The day you were supposed to be born, God spoke it into existence and said, you will be born. The doctor guesses, right? A due date. It's like the postal service saying, we're going to get you your package on time. They are going to hopefully try. And a lot of times they do, but a due date isn't a due date, right, moms? Because how many went past expiration on delivery? It's like, I was due yesterday. Someone come take this child. But it's God. It's who puts it. See, God created life. Now, I want you to get this point. You say, well, what's the purpose of everything under the sun? We got to understand one thing. God created life. Do you understand? When in the garden, God spoke everything into existence. God didn't create death. I want you to think on that. That to me this week as I was reading, that death is the enemy. And death has come about because of what? The curse. Right? God didn't create death. Death is the curse to life. And the reason a lot of us aren't prepared to die because we just think, hey, life is all there is. I want you to know one day we're going to leave here. But what's the plant problem with the planet? Curse of death. Curse of death. All this is about the curse of death. Everything under the sun, everything rolling on this planet is now the curse of death. We read scripture where God created everything beautiful, but sin messed it all up. Right? I mean, just look in the mirror. If you're older, right? Curse every morning. It's like, where'd that wrinkle come from? Where'd that gray hair go? Some, you know what I mean? Go. Because it turned loose, right? Where'd that health go? Curse! The curse! We live under a curse. And so the problem is for us to say, okay, God, what is happening on this planet? How do I make everything that's happening of some sense? He gives us 14 pluses and 14 minuses, and they add up to zero. A time for this, time for that. So he gives us something, takes something away. And so I just want to spend a couple minutes and say, well, what should we do with each season of life? What should we do, understanding things are always going to change? If you're in a blessed moment, enjoy it, right? It's going to change. I hate to tell you, hate to be the bearer of bad news, but Monday is coming. I have never had a life where I lived for the weekend, because my weekends are consumed. I don't even understand this Friday mentality. Oh, it's Friday. Oh, is it? That's awesome. There's no change in my reality of how I have to live. I don't have those extra days off, because if I take a day off, all of what I'm supposed to do still needs to get done. And so I don't get y'all's celebration of a weekend. But I'm glad you have it. Enjoy it. But guess what? Monday's coming. I hate to tell y'all this, 24 hours from now, life's going to change. It won't be blessed like you are right now to be sitting in congregation and enjoying my preaching. Not even a half amen. I have feelings. Remember, let me give you a couple things and we'll be done. Remember, it's a season. Remember, it's a lesson. Remember, it's God. And remember, to enjoy life. So let me just go through this real quick. Remember, it's a season. This is not in Scripture, but some will claim that it is. This too shall pass. I tried to find the origin of this too shall pass. But some say it may have been Solomon who said it first. But who knows? But y'all understand that. I tried to find an illustration for this too shall pass. And the best illustration I could come up with is a match. Matches are interesting. That fire right there could burn me and hurt me. That fire right there could start another fire that could warm the house. It's a season though. Eventually, it will just go out. Now, if I touched it, I'd probably get burned. But I just want you to understand everything you're going through today. Don't focus on the season. It's going to pass. Does it hurt? Yes. Is it problematic? Could be. But the season, don't get so hung up on wanting to stay in a certain season. Will seasons be missed? Yes. There's season I missed. There's several seasons I'm like, man, that'd be kind of cool. This week, I wrote my first birthday card to a Janae Letourneau. Talk about seasons. They change. And so, really, Ecclesiastes chapter 3 wants us to understand everything in life will progress. But not just that it's a season, but remember, it's a lesson. See, you could go back to whatever season God has given him. Now listen, if you don't get this, you're going to just blow away all the seasons. God gives it to us so that we can learn. It's to educate. It's to help us go through life and understand what is happening. This is why when our child gets to that season of why, we get frustrated. But it's a good season for them. Not for us, but for them. Because eventually we're just like, I don't know. Stop asking why. But it's the season. James puts it this way. My brother, count it all joy when you fall into divers temptations. Knowing this, the trying or the working or the pressure put on your faith, worketh patience, but let patience have her perfect work or complete work, that you may grow, be perfect, mature, entire, and wanting nothing. So he's saying, listen, God is taking you through some seasons. And you are to learn from the seasons. Our problem is, a lot of times we don't learn from the seasons. We can just take the cycle of debt. We get into debt thinking we needed money to go do something that we blew on something unnecessary. And then we're in trouble, so we get rescued from debt, and shortly after that, we forget the pain of debt and say, now I can get more so I can enjoy life. So we go through cycles. But God says, I want you to learn from the season, and I'm going to put some things on you so that you can be mature, so that you can grow, so you can prosper. See, when we go through a season, don't look to get out of it as much as you look to learn from it. Say, okay, God, you're in control, right? You're on your throne. I'm going through this season. What are you wanting to teach me? How can you be glorified? How can you work in this situation? Because ultimately, we got to remember it's God, right? If you're a believer, if you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, Romans 8:28 is so true, because we know that all things work together for good. Now, here's the key, the phrase to everything, to them that love God. And if we love God, we follow His commandments, to them who are called according to what? His purpose, not my purpose. And when we understand life is a season and God takes us through these seasons and has a plan to teach us something, understanding that God eventually would put all this together so that we can grow, not for us. Listen, life is not for our benefit. Life is for the purpose and benefit of God. And so when we stop looking at this earth as something for me, but something for God to do and to work and to move in my life, I now can enjoy each season because I know it's designed by God, and I know God's going to teach me as I peruse through life. And it's like, okay, God. You say, well, I ain't happy. It ain't here to be happy. You can enjoy it even though you're not happy about it. Look at what he says as we go on in Romans 8. Who shall separate us, what? From the love of God. And then I want you to know, he gives us everything that's going to happen in life. These could line up as seasons, tribulations or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword. As it is written, for your sake, for God's sake, for the Lord's sake, we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Well, I kind of like Romans 8:28, don't you? Well, all things work together for good to them that love God, to them called according to His purpose. let's not read the rest of the book, because the rest of the book says we may go through some bad times because we live in a fallen place. So we may experience some things that are not of good. Verse 37, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. So in other words, I can go through those seasons we just mentioned because I know God is on the throne and I'm going to conquer them. I'm not going to let them conquer me because God has a purpose. You say there's a purpose in you dying? There's a purpose in you dying. Just as there is a purpose in you living. Now, for I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor heights, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So God says, look, you're going to go through seasons, but you belong to me. And those seasons are lessons to help you go. And those seasons may be valleys. Those seasons may be troublesome. Those seasons may be difficult. But understand, you don't live for yourself. You live for me. Don't understand that my love will still compass you and still help you and still encourage you. You say, why is there sickness? Why is there pain? Why is there problems? Well, it is because we live in a fallen world. And in this fallen world, we no longer belong to it because we belong to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And God says, look, I want to use this not for your pleasure, for my pleasure. So God can be glorified. See, so in it, if our perspective is right, we can remember to enjoy life. You say, enjoy life? You don't know what I'm going through. Now, I understand there's still going to be sorrow. There's still going to be pain. There's still going to be difficulty. But we got to return to the understanding that you're redeemed. Right? I hope you born again this morning. I hope you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. I hope you know you're a sinner separated from God and you'll never make heaven. But you understand Jesus Christ died on the cross to pay the penalty for your sin, and your only hope in this life and in a life eternal is for you to repent and receive Jesus Christ as your Savior. And that love of God then sheds abroad in your heart and you get to celebrate. Break that you're redeemed. Say, man, I'm going through something. Well, go through it as a redeemed child of God. Say, I'm going through bankruptcy. Go through it as a redeemed child of God. I'm going through sickness like I never expected. Go through it as a redeemed child of God. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed in his infinite mercy. His child forever I am. Redeemed. See, we got to get back, people, to understand as children of God, it is not about the circumstance, it's about the Savior we serve. It is not about my situation, but about a God who has victory in every situation. And I get to celebrate who he is because I'm eternal. Right? Look, this world is just going to fade away. And I'm going to live way past it. I'm a child of the King. I know, I tell you, I want to be smart about the planet God gave us and do things to help make the planet better. But guess what? This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. See, when we become just earthly minded, that we think the seasons of this life is all we're going to ever have, and that this is supposed to be heaven, we're going to miss to enjoy the ride. Because this is not all it is. We have eternity. Now, if you're not saved this morning, if you're not born again, if you're not a child of God, let me help you. You should be in distress. Because this is all you got. Because when you leave here, You'll spend an eternity separated from God in a place that's called hell, where the worm dieth not, the Bible says, where the fire is not quenched, the Bible says, and where you'll spend ever and forever and forever in torture, punishment, prison, separated from God. Not because God doesn't love you, it's because you will not repent and receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and as your Savior. But if you're redeemed this morning, you're eternal. I understand. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying, hey, you're having a bad day, have a bad day. I'm just saying, understand it's a season. God has a purpose and a plan. Learn the lesson from where you're going and celebrate Jesus as your Redeemer and your eternal state. Because guess what? I am His. Huh? I'm His. You say, well, does He want me to go through this? Apparently. Does God know what I'm going through? Yeah. Does He understand what I'm going through? Yep. So why is he allowing this? Because there's a bigger plan. Understand? There's a bigger plan. So what's the bigger plan? Well, we go back to the verse 11. We don't know. We can't find out God's ways, right? We don't understand. You say, well, how's He going to use this? I don't know. But when I get to heaven, I'm going to ask. Say, remember, why? How come I wasn't a millionaire, God? I really would have wanted to be one. Y'all looking at me like, I don't want money. I do. Give it to me. I pray to God I'll use it for His honor and glory. But right now, He's like, I don't think you will. So it is. Paul pleaded with God, take away this thorn in my flesh 3 times. And God says, my grace is sufficient for thee. He says, I'm going to keep you where my power and my glory will shine. See, our problem with excess is we forget to pray and talk to God. And sometimes God says, I'm going to keep you where you're going to keep your eyes on me instead of running around like a wild person who thinks you're in control. It's a season. And so we got to remember to stop living with earthly sight. This ain't all there is. There's much, much more. Enjoy what God gives you here. Enjoy the seasons because God has a plan and a lesson. See, it says this in Psalm 23:4, I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Can I give you a little encouragement this morning? You know what the coolest thing about a valley is? There's 2 mountains on either side. And so if you're in a valley this morning, just keep walking. You're heading towards a mountaintop. You're heading towards victory. You're heading towards God doing something. You say, well, what do I need to do? How do I need to function? How do I operate in all of this realm of what God is doing and how God is functioning? I said, well, this right here, this is the conclusion of the matter. You trust God because He's your Redeemer and you get to walk with Him. And I guarantee one thing. If you walk through the valley with God, you'll see victories in your darkest times. God will move. But if you choose to not accept the seasons and not accept the journey and not learn from what God is doing, you're going to be miserable. You're going to get down. You're going to be depressed. And you're going to forsake the God who loves you. This morning, I hope you're saved. I hope whatever season you're going through, if it's bad, it will be short. But if it's good, it will be long. But understand, another season is coming. But we get to walk with the King of kings and Lord of lords. Stand with me. With your heads bowed, eyes closed, attitude of prayer this morning. What season of life are you in? There's some teenagers. Y'all are going through times of uncertainty and trying to figure out life in general. And at the same time, thinking you know life and got it all figured out. Those are difficult times. I never want to downplay, but I want you to know this season will pass. Allow God to teach you, show you, instruct you, encourage you. Some of y'all are parents with children at home. And boy, there's a lot of times of worry. There's a lot of times of wonder. There's a lot of seasons that you just don't know what to say or what to do or where to go. And I just want you to know you walk through that season with God as your Lord. You walk through that season with God as your Savior. You instill into those lives that God has entrusted you with that He is Creator God. Loves them. Died for them on the cross. It's needed. Some of y'all are in seasons of life where grandkids are on the scene. Seasons of life where health seems to be dissipating. Say, well, why God didn't let me go through this? Why is God making this happen? I just want you to know you just keep walking, allowing God to hold your hand and love you even through the valley of the shadow of death. Boy, I just want to have enough. You got enough. Because you got a Redeemer that loves you and died for you and has redeemed you. I pray this morning that we'll stop being earthly minded and start getting a little more heavenly sighted. Because God desires to get victory from your life. Lord, work in our hearts. Move us close to you. We're going to sing. And I just pray right now. My prayer is, if you're struggling in whatever season you're in, would you just come and plead before the Lord? Maybe you want to just come and thank God for the season. As God works and moves, allow Him to change you this morning. Surrender it to Him in Jesus' name. As we sing, you come as God works.